Morning, how are you doing? Now we've got 1 week to go to the election, and it all seems to be all to play for. Move this slide closer. Juan Cavill says, "What's today's topic?" Well, Juan, it's really up to you. I'm here until 10:45, so whatever is taxing you, whatever is vexing you, what you think you should be asking on the doorsteps when they come to you, or even when you're just going to make up your mind. So you tell me what you want to hear. This is a very, very shy audience, very shy. I'll just wait for you yourselves to ask the questions that are on your mind regarding the economy and where we go from here. Vicky, so is the bank guarantee your idea? This is the interesting one. Vicky, I'll tell you what happened. I see that John Gormley is doing what all politicians do, which is failing to take responsibility for his own decisions and deciding that it was always somebody else's problem. Vicky, in September of 2008, on the 6th of September 2008, I went on Saturday View with Brian Lenihan and Richard Bruton, and they were discussing the usual palaver, which is the public-private stuff, and they were going through the usual stuff, and I said, well, guys, there's no point really talking about the public-private stuff because the banks are bust. And they said, oh, no, that's dangerous talk. The banks are not bust. They're well-capitalized, etc. I said, no, they're not. They are definitely in a situation where they cannot get liquidity. And if they can't get liquidity, a situation of illiquidity will lead to a situation of insolvency unless you fix it. So it was fine. And they went off. Brian Lenihan sort of laughed and said, oh, you should one of these days advise me on these things. After all, everybody else is. I didn't know that everybody else was. So I said, fine, I've never spoken to Brian Lenihan in my life. So I headed off. But I was worried about the kind of blasé attitude. And then about 2 weeks later, Brian Lenihan called me and called around to my house. And he said, what would you do? And I said, well, and again, this is somebody I'd never met before. And I wouldn't have been a Fianna Fáil supporter. So it was unusual, given that they sometimes tend to hang out amongst their own, to find him in my own house. But I said, listen, the only country that has ever, ever successfully stopped a run on its banks is Sweden, and it did so in a crisis in 1992, and I think you should look at the Swedish model. And he said, what did that entail? And I said, well, the Swedes guaranteed everything, but what they did was they didn't guarantee subordinated loans. They didn't guarantee, obviously, any shareholders. They put huge and very stringent conditions on the guarantee. The conditions were to fire all bank management, to collapse bad banks into good ones, to close some banks down, to do deals with creditors, to get to the bottom of the situation very, very quickly. The Swedes also devalued their currency, and they did all this in 2 months. So, Vicky, I said to Lenin that the only option you have from history is the Swedish option. And that night I said to him, you better go away and do your ECHR on this, meaning you had better go and get your officials, if you're going to go down this route, to figure out, are the banks lying? Do you know the final cost? If you don't know it, don't do it. If you feel that the banks are being truthful with you, well, then you can have them as partners. But I said to him, you are lending the credibility of the state to the banks for a fixed period in order to calm everything down, and then you can go about rooting out the problem in the banking system without doing it during a crisis. But I did make it very explicit, you were lending credibility. I think what happened in the case of Ireland is that they gave the credibility of the sovereign to the bank without any conditions. But just to clarify, Vicky, I've never been in the Department of Finance to advise anybody. I've never darkened the door of that building to advise anybody on anything. I wasn't involved in the subsequent discussions about the length and the breadth of the guarantee. I was never once consulted on how the Swedish model actually played out. And ultimately what happened was I wrote three articles in support of the Swedish model, two in the Indo, or sorry, two in the Business Post and one in the Indo, ahead of the guarantee. On the weekend of the guarantee, I wasn't even in Ireland, I wasn't even in the continent of Europe, I was in China at a World Economic Forum event that I was speaking at. And I find it hilarious and kind of pathetic that Gormley now has decided, after having spent 2 years in government, after having spent millions and millions of euros on advisors, after having changed the central bank governor, after having done deals with Trichet, etc., to blame me. It's hilarious. You're blaming one guy, the guy who called the thing right, the guy who said the housing market was a scam, the banks were a scam, we were going to end up with negative equity. You blame that guy for the problem? And not the Shawnees, not the Fianna Fáilers, not the developers, not the European Central Bank, not the banks themselves, etc. So, you know, sometimes you just have to live with these things, that in the when a politician is about to lose his seat, as Gormley is, they'll say anything to try and distance themselves by something they perceive to be unpopular. They don't really care about other people's reputation. They don't really care about who is affected. They simply want to make sure that they get elected again. And I think, Vicky, that's where we're at. Okay. So Jim says, what is the realistic cost for any bank guarantee alternatives? Well, this is a good question, Jim. I thought at the time that I said to them, to both Lennon and that, and the interesting thing was that Gormley did call me the week before and after I'd written an article in The Independent and asked me to explain the article. And that was the extent of my advice to John Gormley, was one phone call, of which I didn't get paid for. I should have maybe gotten the 8 million that Merrill Lynch got paid for the same advice, or the 18 million that Arthur Cox got paid for financial advice and economic advice, even though they've no economists on their staff. But so there you go. That's the way the country works. At the time, we had the situation where the Swedes had, it seemed to me, Jim, that what would have happened was the run of the banks would have continued and the big depositors would have taken the deposits out, as we see the MTMA had already taken its deposits out of Anglo. And what would have happened is the little guy would have got screwed, as always. That was my sense of what was happening at the time. The problem with the guarantee in subsequent months and years, and you'll see that I wrote very kind of almost in dismay about it after about a month, because I could see what was happening was that they were using the guarantee, the insiders, to really bail themselves out. And I naively thought that we would behave like Swedes, but we didn't. We behaved like paddies, and not like paddies, but like a cabal of paddies. And maybe that's the lesson, is don't take a Scandinavian model and try to superimpose it in Ireland, because it will be used and abused for the ends of those who it's meant to expose. It's not credible, is it? Here's Kieran Ryan. For the ECB to respond to the destruction of some bank investors' capital by responding with measures that would bring about the total destruction of the bank investor capital. Yes, Kevin, I suppose you're talking about where the ECB is at the moment. I think that we've got to go back to first principles. We don't own this debt. The government guarantee was a policy to try and calm the situation down. It can be reversed. In fact, it should be reversed. And we have a choice between a sovereign default or a bank default. The sovereign default is a disaster for us. And the bank default is simply just reinstating the rules of capitalism. So I suspect that the ECB are being very self-defeating in this regard. The problem is that the ECB, by forcing upon the Irish taxpayers the debts of Sean Fitzpatrick, are going to make the Irish taxpayer, the Irish citizen, very anti-European. You know, I'm sure Euroscepticism would be the ultimate. Even if you read the editorials of some of the newspapers now, they're getting very, very Eurosceptical. So I think if the ECB were to behave like good Europeans, what they would realize is that there's a long game here, and you shouldn't penalize the Irish people for the gambling debts of Deutsche Bank and some of the other German banks who lent to the Irish banks, because it will ultimately lead to Euroscepticism. And that is something that they should worry about. This is why I believe we should have a referendum on these issues because the issues are simply too big. And in a way, it gives the Europeans a way out. Okay, so Neil, when we say burden sharing of bank holders, if we get this to happen, 50% of the bondholders are Irish. Are we not saving money on one side, then losing on the other? Well, Neil, that's a fair point, but I don't believe that a single mother in Tallaght should pay for the mistakes of a pension fund who managed my pension. Let's say, for example, you have someone like me who has a private pension fund, and it's operated by, you know, I pay into it every month. I used to pay more into it every month than I am now, but that's the way it goes. And let's say it's been managed, and I use the term, it's not been managed by Irish Life. Let's say it is been managed by Irish Life, right? Now, if Irish Life in 2007 used my money to buy bonds of Anglo-Irish Bank, then it's my problem. It's my problem. It's not anybody else's problem. And if we now say that a single mother in Tallaght should pay to bail out David McWilliams' pension, which is exactly the argument we made that the bondholders are Irish and therefore we can't anyway go near them, it means that people whose house prices have fallen, like all of ours, that's cool. People whose share portfolio fell, if you had a pension in shares, that's okay. People who lost their job, that's okay. But people who owned bonds and their private pensions, that's not okay. We'll bail them out. But the other three or four things we won't bail out. It just doesn't wash. So either we have a capitalist country or we don't. And I think that the argument is thrown there as a red herring to try and obscure the overall argument, Neil, which is that we are insolvent. And the way you solve a problem of too much debt is never more debt, it's actually less debt. And therefore we have to negotiate not on the interest rate, but on the principle. And I think this can happen. I've no reason to believe that this won't happen. Jim says, were the Swedes insolvent or illiquid? I think the Swedes thought at the time that they were illiquid in the same way as we did. What the Swedes did was they found out the facts very quickly. And by that I mean they announced the guarantee, and then they spent 8 weeks looking at the details of the guarantee, as we did. And during that 8 weeks in Sweden, they fired all the top managers, they got their own people in, and they made an assessment, Jim, as to whether they were insolvent or illiquid. And they found that certain banks were insolvent, so they closed them down, and they burned the bondholders. They did deals with the creditors, right? Other banks they believed they could keep going, so they pumped capital into them. But interestingly, they never, and this is why I was saying the Swedish model was the way to go, they didn't put 1 cent of government, of public money, of our money, into the banks until all the shares, share capital had gone, all the subordinated debt capital had gone, and they were down to the bare bones. So the Swedes were in a similar situation to ourselves, but they found out the facts, they didn't allow their mates money to the waters, and the guarantee worked there perfectly, as it would have done in the textbook. And that's how I thought it would have worked here, but I was wrong, clearly, and probably naive to think that we could have replicated the Swedes. The Swiss did something very similar in the early 90s as well, with great success. But maybe the only commonality between Sweden, Switzerland, and Ireland is neutrality. At the end of the day, I think everything else you can assume that those guys do it right, and we take something and then just bail out our mates, which seems to have happened. Andy, what are the likely consequences of a sovereign default? It will be a disaster, Andy. An absolute disaster, because countries that default on their sovereign tend to spend a long time in the wilderness, particularly a country like Ireland that depends so much on American capital for its industrial base. I think a sovereign default would cause the Americans to fly. I also believe that if we defaulted on the sovereign, well, then what's to stop me, David McWilliams, saying, well, you know, we just defaulted the sovereign, so screw it, I'll default on my car loan, and I'll default on this, that, and the other, and the whole house of cards could come tumbling down. In fact, if you want to hear about the implications, the ramifications of that, tomorrow I have a show on News Talk. I'm doing two or three shows for them before the election and one after. And I'm interviewing an old friend of mine, a guy called Martin Lestow, who was the last finance minister of Argentina. And he's talking about that. I recorded the interview last night with him. And he talks about the consequences of default in Argentina, what happened. And it'll be well worth having a listen to that. So the consequences of a sovereign default are incredibly scary. And that's why I'm arguing very strongly now that we separate the banks from the sovereign, because we are going to default on the sovereign if we don't. The numbers are just too big. They're too big. For example, think about it. In the last 3 weeks, the Irish banking system has issued 18 billion euros worth of bonds with a government guarantee stamp stuck on it. 18 billion euros in 3 weeks. That's a hole in their balance sheet that they need to fill of 18 billion euros. We only raise 14 billion euros every year in income tax. So the banks have managed to blow in the last 3 weeks more money than we raise in the whole year in income tax. That's why I'm petrified about a sovereign default, because it looks to me as if we can't avoid it unless we separate the banks. Liam Den says, considering the carnage of the last few years and how quickly things changed, what's to say our deposits will be safe? Was it not the case in Argentina that depositors were ruined? Well, Liam, I have been arguing, and I can say I did it publicly on the stage of the Abbey last June, that, and the reason I say this is people always talk about, well, you know, you create the conditions for a bank run if you say there might be one. I don't trust the Irish banks about with anything at all. And as a consequence of that, I don't believe that my deposits would be safe in an Irish bank. So I don't believe that your deposits are completely safe in an Irish bank. And the reason I don't believe it is because it's hard to take seriously the utterances and the promises of these guys who have lied to us about everything. You're right, in Argentina the depositors were ruined. And of course I would get completely attacked now for prompting for even discussing this, but it's a bit like, it reminded me of, do you remember during the house price scam, when people like me said house prices were far too high and they would fall? We were accused of talking down the economy, and the very utterance of actually suggesting there was a problem meant that the house prices would become self-fulfilling. Now, I think ultimately the truth is much more important than the spin. And it's hard to trust the Irish banks at this stage. Very hard. Okay. Neil, it might be a very stupid question, but can the ECB not simply print the money? The Fed calls it quantitative easing. Is this an option? Neil, you're absolutely right. I mean, the ECB is going to run itself into its own cul-de-sac. It prints the money. It's not a big deal. It's already given us, lent us over 100 billion euros. You know, we can quite easily do a deal where that money stays in Ireland. And over time, we simply convert that into a loan. And we say, yeah, we pay it back, we give you 1% for the next 10 years, and we give you 2% after that. I mean, there are things we can do, but you're absolutely right. The central bank is only doing what central banks do, which is to lend money at last resort. To put conditions on that means you don't understand central banking at all, which is what I believe the ECB doesn't understand. And as you said, the Federal Reserve just prints the money and gets on with it. And in actual fact, the Irish issue, the Irish numbers are very, very small in the European context and could be dealt with very manageably. So yes, Neil, you're right. Mary Fitzgibbon. Both Fianna Fáil and Fine Gael repeat the mantra that we ran out of money and the proposal of bank default implies that we will have no money to pay the teachers. No money for the teachers and the doctors and the guards. This is complete and utter nonsense. If we separated the bank debt from the sovereign debt, our debt GDP ratio falls to 73%. This is a debt-GDP ratio, which is a crucial figure because it's your ability to pay, which is lower than France's, Spain's, Italy's, Germany's, Austria's, Belgium's, and of course Greece's and Portugal's. So we could go back to the markets very quickly. You would organize a bridging loan with the IMF, because that's what the IMF does. And I think the IMF is actually more on our side than the EU, where the ECB seems to be at the moment. You organize a bridging loan with the IMF that tides you over for 3 or 4 months, and you then go back to the markets with a much cleaner balance sheet, and you get ready to raise money. And then obviously you have to have a fiscal adjustment which is credible. Like, you have to have a policy which says that over the next 4 years we're going to do this, 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 and this, and the markets have to believe you. You could also go to the Federal Reserve and look for a loan, which would really piss off the ECB, but it could be done. And you could certainly do it on the basis of selling to the Americans that this is for corporate America as well as for Ireland. You could also go to China and look for a bridging loan. I mean, we are a sovereign country. There are options. What we have done is we've allowed ourselves to be dictated by a conversation that has been framed by somebody else. And the European Central Bank, unfortunately, has turned into a very stern and narrow and not particularly inspiring partner in this regard. They're a central bank. They should behave like one, not like a moral authority for a nation. So it is propaganda, Mary. We would get financed elsewhere, but we'd have to go out and actively seek it. It's a wee bit like saying you need a bridging loan. Well, if you don't go and talk to another bank, you're not going to get the loan. The money's not going to come to you. You've got to go out and get it. Juan says, should we scrap the minimum wage deal and set a maximum wage deal for workers? Well, I don't. You could do that, Juan. I think what is interesting is, if you look at Ireland and Britain together, it's more or less one labour market in terms of where people emigrate to or what have you. You'll have noticed in the boom, a huge amount of English workers over here and now a huge amount of Irish workers over here. So for Ireland to be competitive, I think it's probably fair to say that you shouldn't be that far out of line with your British minimum wage, let's say, to take it. We are now 10% above the British minimum wage at 7.70. Fine Gael and Labour want to reinstate the old minimum wage, which would put us at a premium on the minimum wage, I think about 30% to our British counterparts. Now, the reason I say that is it's important that we don't price ourselves out of the market. And the market for labour is the market for labour that we share, which is with Britain. And I think we want to be very, very careful about raising the minimum wage from here, because I would think that the best thing we could do to attract in employment here is to give tax breaks to employers, to change the conversation in their heads, to make sure that when an employer goes to bed, they're not going to bed as they are now thinking, who might I have to fire in the morning, but they go to bed thinking, who might I hire in the morning? So if the conversation shifts from firing to hiring, then I think we're in the beginning of a virtuous cycle. And how do you do that? Well, we know that Irish people respond to tax breaks disproportionately than other nations. So why do you think we have so many ghost states? Why do you think we have so many car parks? Why do you think we have so many tax-driven, tax-sheltered developments? Because Irish people respond to tax breaks. So they created a bubble in construction. Wouldn't it be amazing to create a bubble in employment by skewing the tax system towards rewarding those with the tax breaks who actually might go and employ somebody in the morning? Now, we have 200,000 small firms in Ireland. Small businesses, I run one small business. I'm sure many people on the call here are business people too. If all of us employed one extra person, that would be 200,000 people. You'd actually halve the unemployment rate very quickly. So it can be done. I really believe it can be done, but it won't be done by focusing on the minimum wage. Okay. Colin Casey. Let me have a look. I'm just looking here more at some of the questions coming in. bear with me. Okie dokie. Ricky says, I'm an individual who is concerned with our current situation. I'm sorry if I have not joined in this populist circle jerk. Interesting. Hold on, sorry, I can't. But I would rather act as a rational critic. Okay, Ricky, tell me a little bit more. Maybe you come back to me on that one. I just didn't quite follow that. Okay. I'm just trying to read here. A tax break, Colm Casey, for employers. Yeah, what I'm talking about here, Colm, is really trying to change the incentives for people to employ others. Because the way you generate employment is you change the incentives to make it easier to employ. Now, if you look at the bank deal, let's just do a couple of back of the envelope numbers here, right? If you look at the bank deal, there's 21 billion of, these are the numbers for the bank debt, right? It's 21 billion of unguaranteed debt. It's 22 billion of what is called collateralized debt, okay? Or debt which has got an asset on the far side of it. These are the banks. And then there's 34 billion of recent government guaranteed debt, which is, again, the use of the guarantee that I would have balked at, which was using the guarantee during the, what the government allowed banks to do was to swap old maturities into the guarantee period and thereby put us on the hook. It's an extraordinary thing to do. There's 34 billion of those new debts out there. So add those up, we've got, you know, 34 and 22, 50, 56 odd, 77 odd billion of bank related bonds out there, right? Now, of the 22 billion, right, which is securitized assets, you just simply, if there's assets on the far side, when you give them back to the loan, to the owner, so they've nothing to worry about, they should be fine. The 21 billion of unguaranteed debt, you just simply force a debt for equity swap, you get rid of that. And the 34 billion, you do exactly the same thing. So what in fact you restructure and you reimagine these debts, which is 55 billion, right? If you do that in the morning, okay, 55 billion of debt, let's say at 55 billion at 5%, that is costing us in Ireland somewhere about 2.7 odd billion in interest rates alone, interest payments alone every year. If you save that 2.7 billion and gave that as a tax break to employers, it would translate at a tax break of around over 3,000, close to 3,000, it'll be over 3,000 for every unemployed person. So that is a huge incentive to employ those people. And what I'm saying is that we've got to be a little bit creative in how we approach things. But intervening in the labor market is the way to go very rapidly and with great with great force. So you do it very, very quickly and you explain to people what's going on. For example, as an employer, I would find that very attractive. I would find that might make the difference between saying, yes, I'll take somebody on, or no, I won't. So that's the way we've got to do. We've got to actually get inside the heads of the people who might employ. That's what I believe to be the case. Now, there are arguments about fairness and there's arguments about equity, and I take all those. I have no problem in answering those, but I equally think that when you have close to 500,000 people on the labour, if you could reduce that figure rapidly by giving an incentive to those, the only people who can reduce that figure are those who might employ, then I think we're on the right road. And if you used the interest payments that we would save by not paying the bondholders for debts that the bondholders themselves are responsible for, then you seem to be in a win-win situation. Ricky, why would bondholders agree to debt for equity swap for work of the shares in Zombies Bank? Well, they wouldn't, Ricky. You have to force it. And that's what the Americans did in the savings and loans scandal in the early 1990s. That's what I worked for Tony O'Reilly and Dennis O'Brien. Tony O'Reilly and Dennis O'Brien forced the bondholders of the Irish Independent Group last year to take a debt for equity swap in a company where the shares had fallen by 90%. Ricky, it's not about, you know, an ideal world where you and I sit down and we're in good form and I say, here's the deal. These deals are going to be very nasty and somebody's going to pay. And there's no way in the world the bondholders would willingly accept the promise of shares tomorrow for the actuality of cash in their back pocket today. But nonetheless, we don't have the cash. They've got to realize we don't have the money. And better a debt for equity swap, which is the way that most bankrupt countries and bankrupt companies deal with their creditors. Better a debt for equity swap where they own the banks. And over time, we work together to get the bank share price up as the economy recovers and maybe they'll get some of their money back. That, I believe, Ricky, is the only way out. It's not going to be pretty. It's not going to be in any way easy. As I said last week, you need a bollocks to do this deal. You don't need a nice guy or an academic economist or a media commentator like me and media economists like me. What you need is a complete bollocks who's done these deals before. I wrote an article a while ago from the mart in County Clare in Ennis, where I was watching the farmers trading cattle. And I thought to myself, those guys would do a much better deal because they know what to do, because that's their game. Last year, an Irishman, Barry O'Callaghan, presided over the biggest corporate restructuring on Wall Street with great skill. This is a corporate restructuring, and that's exactly the way we've got to go. Let's have a look there. Keep going down. Okay. Asked Brian this yesterday about interest in your opinion. This is Colin. Okay. I asked Brian this yesterday about interest in your opinion. The total figure of sovereign debt, including bank guarantees, is around 300 billion. However, the bailout is merely 85. One side bodily wrong, or is there a way to make these figures? Agree. Colin, the bailout is meant to be a loan which tides us over a four-year period, which allows us to breathe again. So the total figure of sovereign debt, it's not the total figure that you need to look at, but the sovereign debt itself. The sovereign debt of Ireland is about 90 billion, maybe a little bit more. It's eminently payable in a non-crisis situation. The bailout is simply a loan, but the problem is, you see, the bailout is a loan which is incurring more debt to pay back the original debt, and it's like anything. It's like, for example, if you, let's say you rock up a 15 grand on your credit card, and then you get a term loan to pay it off. You're not addressing the issue of debt. What you're addressing is you're just incurring more debt to pay old debt and you'll end up bankrupt. So that's what we're doing in the same way. Ricky, how would the market respond to our meddling in business management? We're already teetering on the brink in terms of willingness to do business here. I think the market would respond very well, actually. The market wants the country to grow. It doesn't want the country to be strangled. You know, what we're doing now is we're kind of strangling ourselves with all these debts and undermining our ability to grow. The market wants us to grow. So I think you've got to, you call it meddle. I'd say it's I'm sure you're talking here about the idea of changing the tax structure to employ more people. I think you're talking about that, Ricky. People need solutions. They really need solutions. And companies that are bust go bust, problems get solved and they turn around, and that's what we've got to do. Rather than letting the market, we know that the free market has failed. We know that light regulation and saying, don't worry, you'll be grand, all that sort of stuff has failed us. You know, we need to go in and say, we have a choice. The choice is to make it easier to employ. Let's do it. We have a choice. The choice is not to pay the debts of people who actually took out those debts willingly when they were private companies. Give it back to them. These are the choices we've got to make. Otherwise, what we're going to do is we're going to go bust very slowly and painfully, and we will emigrate. Maybe the likes of ourselves will emigrate. I think I'm from that generation which is probably too old to emigrate, but too young to give up. But that's not the case for many, many thousands. We'll just leave the country, and the country will be hollowed out. And what we'll have is a big multinational sector, very well capitalized, doing very well, and a large public sector, and small businesses will disappear. And that's the way we're going. That's the upshot for this country. And we can't let that happen, because then the essence of the country is to become a concubine of the European Union. They will continue to give us some money. We will continue to play the game. The multinationals will employ on very good wages, maybe 150,000 people. The public sector will expand and will be allowed to expand. And the private sector, such as we understand it, will disappear. A, because we can't pay the debts. B, because we're sitting in negative equity. I don't mean that just in terms of housing, but I mean that in terms of companies which have huge debts on their balance sheets. And C, because we tolerate it as a people. So, Ricky, that's the reason I'm involved in the people's economy, because what I see coming down the street is such an appalling vista that we've got to try and change it as much as we possibly influence it, make decisions, etc. Okay. Trish says, what happens to those of us who have to stay? I couldn't ever agree with you. With me, I'm in the same boat, Trish, which is why I'm like, as a concerned citizen and a father, you know, husband and all those things, I'm more worried about what's going on in this country than I would have been, let's say, if I was 21 or 22. I'd say, okay, it's good. I'm off to Australia. Okay. Colin says, Trish, I'm planning to move home. David, am I mad? No, come home, Colin, and we'll fight this one together. Let me have a look here at another question. What are, in your opinion, the most important reforms necessary to our banking system? Rather than recapitalizing zombie banks and allowing them to limp on, shouldn't the framework undergo a wholesale restructuring? For starters, what's the distinction between deposit, warehouse banks, and loan banks? Now, I believe that this is the big issue, right? The Irish banking system sector is going to get much smaller over the course of the next few years. And I think that the zombie bank should now just be killed. I think it's a patriotic thing to do. I think it is the only thing to do is to actually close down most of the banks that are zombies. And that also probably extends to AIB. And when I say close it down, I mean merge it into Bank of Ireland. We're a small country in a banking crisis with a credit crunch. We don't need any number of banks. We need one or two decent banks. We need one bank which deals with, you know, checkbooks and clearing and deposits and ATMs, that sort of stuff, the stuff that we understand to be banking. And then we need another bank that operates in the area of loans, of business loans. We don't need a mortgage bank anymore. I believe we should introduce a reform which focuses on the collateral, which says that the collateral extended to land-based projects, houses and developments, should not be based on the collateral value yesterday, but based on the collateral value, the average collateral value of the last 30 years. And in so doing, once you backward index the thing on an average of 30 years, you smooth out all the previous booms and busts. The collateral then becomes constant, and the amount of money to be extended to property and land-based deals becomes almost fixed. In that way, you actually rule out forever in the future any further booms and busts in housing. And that then rules out any further booms and busts in banks, because the banks won't have the incentive to do so. And the banks turn into utilities, like water companies or electricity companies, which simply extend the service of electricity to us, and we pay for it, and that's the deal. We pay them, they give us the service, and share. And I think that's the way forward for the Irish banks. I think that's the only way forward. And in a way, you've got to use a horrible expression, de-bank the country. What I see happening, though, on the other hand, is I believe that what will happen here quite soon is a new bank will emerge. And that bank will be a foreign bank. It will have a large deposit base in its own home country. It will have a AAA rating. It will go and buy up the infrastructure of, let's say, AIB, the ATMs, some of the retail banking networks. It will be able to provide accounts, deposits. You'll be able to use your ATMs. But all the clearing will be done in Europe. I think that's going to happen. And I think that would be actually quite a good thing. I don't believe that we should do anything as citizens in terms of the banking industry except have a banking system that ensures that people like my mother don't worry about her deposits. I think that's a success. That's a win. And I suspect over the course of the next year, you will see that bank emerge. And that bank will suck in enormous deposits from Irish people because it will be unencumbered by the nonsense of the last 10 years. That's how I see it working. Okay, okay, let's go back up. There's a lot of questions coming. Ricky again. Why can't we rescind the guarantee and sell them off as going concerns? We lose the debt and the ATMs are stocked. Well, that's, Ricky, you're right with me on that. We might not have to sell them as a going concern, Ricky. We might have to give them away because nobody will buy them. But yeah, that's the deal. You sell them. It's a bank resolution. The old money gets hammered. New money takes all the advantage. It's like if, you know, for example, if a restaurant goes bust, the creditors, the old creditors lose everything. The new creditors come in and they take things for half nothing. And the restaurant opens its doors and starts again. That's the way capitalism works. This is what I'm saying, Ricky. All these, you know, weird things. We'll have NAMA, we'll have this and that. But they just obscure the final solution, which is let's just let normal rules of capitalism play out. Banks are no different. They should be no different. But over the last few years, we've realized that they are different beasts in terms of how they're treated. And those of us, I come back to it, who believed that we could do a guarantee a la Sweden were probably had a better understanding of economics than we did of the Irish power structure and power base, to my eternal regret, actually. There you go. Okay, Colin. It's now 10:45. This is the last question I'll take if you don't mind. But we start again on Monday with this tutorials and tutorials discussions. And but by all means, just email into thepeopleseconomy.com if you've other questions, and we'll try and get them all answered. And if not, we might put on extra tutorials. And you know what we might do even after the election? Why don't we do these things anyway and just to discuss economics in a free and open way? Because the problems ain't going to go away next Friday afternoon. So if that sounds good with people, we'll probably do that. I'll figure out a way of doing it. Last question here is... Sorry. Iceland is usually touted as a model for Ireland, except for, of course, they can devalue to remain competitive. Given there's now upward pressure on interest rates, what are we going to have to do differently to emulate their relative success? Well, Cole, it's a good question, right? The Icelandics, I went up to Iceland to see it last year, you know, to see what it looks like in terms of a country that is a basket case. And it didn't seem like a basket case at all. In actual fact, tomorrow on my news talk program, it says plugging away, I'm going to introduce the new Icelandic Minister for Culture. There is a big event, an Ireland-Iceland event happening on Saturday week in Dublin, and I'll get you the details, I'll put them up on the site. But come back to your point, we can't devalue. Well, there are those of us who believe that if the euro were to implode as a result of all this crisis, it wouldn't be a bad thing for us at all. But that's a different scale. And I'm one of the very few who believes that, but there you go. And I'll come back to that maybe at a later date. That if it were to implode, it wouldn't be a bad result for us at all. But what we've got to do is got to realize all we can do is reduce our burden of debt within the euro. And as a consequence of that, we need to sever the banks from the sovereign. And we really need to give the bank debt back to the people who took it out in the first place, who were the bondholders. there's 100 billion of ECB money here. We have to tell the ECB they're just going to have to forget about getting that back for the next few years. And you know what we could do then at a later stage? We can convert some of those deposits into capital, into share capital, and the ECB would just end up owning some of the Irish banking system. But that's what we've got to do. That's the way out. Otherwise, we're going to have this long, prolonged agony, which is going to lead to higher unemployment, higher immigration, and ironically, will lead to a terrible anti-European feeling here, which will be the opposite of what the ECB want to happen. So listen, best of luck. Have a good weekend. Thank you all for tuning in. And we'll see you next Monday. And as I said, we should continue these discussions on over the course of the weeks after the election. Take care. Bye-bye.